Let's see a new protocol, the next one, CSMACD. CSMACD is the access control method, and what does it say is, I'll tell you the name of it first of all. CS means carrier sensing. Carrier sensing. So which means I'll tell you that. And then MA means multiple access. Multiple access. And CD means collision detection. Okay, I'll tell you the meaning of each one. CS means carrier sensing, MA means multiple access. So multiple access means it is nothing but if you have a channel, many stations are trying to access it. That is the meaning of multiple access. Multiple access is nothing but broadcast channel, right? And now CS means here in this protocol, in this access control method, any station can transmit data at any time. So there is no need of reservation, there is no need of polling. Any station could transmit data anytime. Only one condition is applied, that is carrier sensing, which means before sending the data, you just sense the carrier. If the carrier is free, you could send the data, otherwise you refrain. Which means before sending the data, let us say there are stations A, B like this. Now if A wants to send the data, only thing it has to do is before sending it, you sense the carrier, and if the carrier is free, you send the data, otherwise you don't send the data. But it is a problem. The problem is standing at this point A, A cannot sense the entire carrier. A can sense only this point, right? The point of contact, which means A, by looking at only this point, should understand whether the entire link is free or not, which is very difficult, right? So if you look out of this peephole, how can you find out whether someone is there in the road or not? So it is very difficult. That is the reason why there will be some problem here. So according to the protocol says that any station can send data at any time, no problem. But then only condition is before sending the data, you are supposed to sense the carrier, and in case if the carrier is free, then you transmit the data. If the carrier is having some signal here, then you don't send the data, right? So that is what carrier sensing means. Okay, and now the let us take this example. Say A wants to send the data and B wants to send the data at the same time, and both of them have sensed the carrier at this point. B has sensed it and A has sensed it, right? And both of them found out that there is no signal, and so they are good to go according to this access control method. So A started transmitting the data. At the same time, B also started transmitting the data, and now there is a collision, right? So whenever two stations transmit the data at the same time, there could be a chance of collision. Collision is nothing but your data bits are got corrupted, and whatever you see is a garbage value. Right, so this is a undesired condition. Now the collision signal is traveling on both the sides, and now the collision signal has reached the ends, which means collision signal is seen by A as well as collision signal is seen by B. Okay, now how can A and B know that their data is lost in the collision and they have to retransmit? So generally, if you have an acknowledgement system, and if you send a data and if you don't get the acknowledgement, you will be very sure that your data is lost in the collision. But the problem in the CSMACD is we don't have acknowledgements also. So CSMACD doesn't use acknowledgements. The reason is this is used in a LAN protocol, and many of the LANs doesn't have acknowledgements. So CSMACD doesn't have acknowledgement. Now A has sent the data, and the data is got, data got involved in a collision and the data is lost. Then how can A know that it is its own data which got lost in the collision? That is called collision detection, which means the sender should even detect the collision if its data got involved in one. So the problem here is any station can send data at any time, and multiple stations are connected to the channel. Okay, and before sending any data, every station is supposed to sense the carrier. If the carrier is free, it could send the data, otherwise it is supposed to refrain. That is why carrier sensing. and there are no acknowledgments in CSMA CD, which means when you are sending the data, if your data is lost in collision, it is the responsibility of the sender to detect that there is a collision and to stop the transmission or sorry retransmit the packet, right? So how can A or B, whose data got involved in collision, know that it is their own data which got lost? Let's see this example. Say there is A here and there is B here. I'm just putting them at the opposite ends. There is no much significance for this. So A's packet, A started transmitting, this is A's packet, and B has started transmitting, it is B's packet. And after some time, A's packet reached till here, and after some time B's packet reached till here, and now there is collision, and now the both the packets are lost and collision signal came back. Now when A and B see this collision signal, they will think that, see, we have already transmitted our packets, therefore the collision signal whichever is coming back doesn't correspond to our data. This could be someone else's data too, right? So how can A be sure that the data which is lost or the collision signal which is coming back is because of its own packet? A will be sure that its own packet got involved in collision only if it is still transmitting the packet and it got back the collision signal, which means if the packet size is long enough that if the packet is large enough that let us say the packet is large enough that by the time collision signal comes back to you, if you are still having some data to transmit, or while you are still transmitting the data, if there is a collision with B's data, okay, if this is the case, which means you are still transmitting the data and by that time the collision signal came back, in this case only A or B will be sure that its own data is lost in the collision. Otherwise they will never be sure that it is their own data which got lost in collision. So in order to detect the collision, in worst case what we should do is we should keep on transmitting the data until we get back the collision, if there is any. If there is no collision, we are not going to get back the collision signal, right? So let us analyze it a bit more. How much time do we need and all? So this is station A and station B. Just for the sake of example, the transmission delay from this end to this end, sorry, the propagation delay, assume that the propagation delay is 1 hour, okay? The propagation delay from this end to this end is 1 hour. Now which means if I leave a bit here, it will take 1 hour for the bit to appear at the other end. Now assume that time T is 10 a.m. And at this time A and B senses the carrier and both of them starts the data. Okay, so at 10 a.m. A and B starts transmitting. Okay, now at 10 a.m. both of them have started transmitting, which means both of them first bit is here, right? Then what happens at 10:30? At 10:30 a.m. what happens? See, now if the total propagation delay is 1 hour, which means the time taken for this bit or that bit to come to the other end is 1 hour. Now if I give it half an hour time, what happens is both the bits will reach exactly the halfway and collide, which means this bit will reach the halfway and stand in the middle, and this bit will reach the halfway and stand in the middle, and there will be a collision between these two bits, and behind them there will be other bits emitted by B and there will be other bits emitted by A. Okay, so at 10:30 exactly there will be a collision, right? And now the collision will produce a different signal called collision signal, which will be different frequency than the data. Okay, now by what time will that collision signal reach the reach A or B? If you see it, at exactly 11 a.m. why? Because from here to here, the time taken is half an hour, and from the collision signal, for the collision signal to come from here to here or here to here, exactly one more half an hour, which means exactly 1 hour. So at time equal to 11 a.m., both A and B will see collision signal, isn't it? Will see collision signal, right? So in this example, both A and B are seeing the collision signal exactly after 1 hour, exactly after 1 TP. So in this example, if A and B have to understand that it is their own data which got lost in collision, then transmission delay for A and B should be greater than propagation delay, isn't it? For this example, which means by the time collision signal comes back to you, if you still have some more data to transmit and if you are still doing that, then you'll know that, oh, I'm still transmitting the data and I got the collision signal back, which means definitely my data I got involved in collision. Therefore, in this example, if I have to be sure that my data is the data which got involved in collision and lost, then TT should be greater than TP for this example. But then in worst case, if I start transmitting data at 10 a.m., after what time or after how much time will I get back the collision signal? Which means, this is, in this example, we got that after 1 hour, we are getting the collision signal, which means after one propagation delay, we are getting the collision signal. My question is, if A starts transmitting now, after how much time, if the propagation delay is 1 hour, if A starts transmitting now, after how much time, in worst case, will I get the collision signal back? So this depends on this. See, so in worst case, the first bit will reach the other end. Let us say A starts at 10 a.m. At 10 a.m., A starts. Which means A started transmitting. See, 1 hour is too big, but instead of taking milliseconds, I have taken 1 hour. So don't worry about the time. It is not practical, but still it will, clarify the example better. Now, at 10 a.m., A started transmitting. Okay. So at exactly, it is almost going to be 11 a.m. Okay, which means it is about to be 11 a.m. It is not at 11 a.m. exactly, it is almost going to be 11 a.m. Then what happens is, the first bit of A is almost at the other end and it is about to reach the B. Okay. Now at this point, let us say B starts. Why? Because B has sensed the carrier and at this point there is no bit, but first bit of A is about to reach, but it didn't yet reach, which means according to B, when it sends the carrier, the entire carrier is free, but then A's bit is not yet reached, it is about to reach. Now B's first bit is just now transmitted and now there will be collision between these two. If there is a collision between these two bits, the first bit of A and first bit of B, then the collision signal will start traveling from this end, isn't it? Then when will there be collision? Exactly at 11 a.m. there will be collision, right? At 11 a.m. there will be collision, right? And then after 1 hour, which means at 12 o'clock, A will see the collision signal, right? So in this is the worst case example, where after how much or after what is the worst case time after which A could get the collision signal is 2 hours, which is nothing but 2 into TP. Therefore, if A has to detect the collision in this case, then A has to transmit the data, or it should have at least that much amount of data that it should transmit at least till 2 into TP. So this is the worst case time and this is the condition. And the previous example, it is not for the worst case. This is the worst case. Therefore, if you follow this, we can detect all the cases. If I follow this time, then no case could escape. So if I start transmitting now, after 2 into TP time, I might get the collision signal in the worst case. Therefore, within that time, if I have to detect the collision, I should still be transmitting the data. So in this case, TT should be greater than or equal to 2 into TP, right? So this is the condition for collision detection. Okay, now if I have to transmit the data for at least 2 into TP, if my transmission time has to be 2 into TP, then what, how much data should I have? I should have data large enough so that, you know, it, I could transmit at least for this much time. So now my next question is, you understood that in order to detect the collision, I should be transmitting at least for 2 into TP time. Then if I have to transmit for at least 2 into TP time, okay, then how much data should I have so that I could transmit for this much amount of time? L by B should be greater than or equal to 2 into TP, which means L should be greater than or equal to 2 into TP into bandwidth. This is the minimum size of the packet in order to detect the collision. This is the condition for collision detection, and this is the minimum size of the packet, which means you should have at least this much size packet in order to detect the collision. If you don't have this much amount of packet, we will not be able to detect the collision. So depending on this formula, these two formulas, there will be some questions. They will say that the distance of the questions will be like this. You could practice them. They will say that the distance of the CSMACD network is so and so, and the velocity of the signal is so and so, and the bandwidth is so and so. Then what should be the minimum data size in order to detect the collision? This is the most popular question in GATE. Almost every year they'll ask this. So it's simple. You know, using D by V, you can find out TP, propagation delay, and then 2 into TP into bandwidth is going to be L. Therefore, you can find out the minimum length of the packet using this formula. And what does it mean is, if you want to send some data using CSMACD networks, you should have a minimum amount of data. Otherwise, you should not, you know, you will not be able to, you should not send it, because you will not be able to detect the collision. What should be that minimum amount of data? This much. Now, what if, let's take some example. Let us say TP is 1 millisecond and bandwidth is 1 Mbps. Okay, in this case, what should be the minimum length of the packet in order to detect the collision in CSMACD? Then minimum length of the packet is greater than or equal to 2 into 1 millisecond, which is 10 power minus 3 into bandwidth. Bandwidth is 10 power 6. Therefore, length has to be greater than or equal to 2000 bits, right? So if you convert it into bytes, if you convert these bits to bytes, then length should be equal to, I think, to 400 bytes. Okay, is it 400? It is not 400. Okay, let's keep it in bits. So let us say this is 2000 bits. Now your packet should be at least 2000 bits. If you don't have 2000 bits to transmit, then what you should do is, you should pad extra bits. Let us say you have only 1000 bits to transmit in a frame or in a packet, but then if you are using a CSMACD network, then what you should do is, you should append 1000 dummy bits in order to transmit it. Otherwise, you are not supposed to transmit it. Okay. So this is about the collision detection and CSMACD. Important points are, first thing is, any station can transmit data at any time. There are no reservations, there is no polling, and only one condition is, before sending the data, you send the carrier. If carrier is free, you can send it. If it is not free, you have to refrain. And next important point is, there will be collisions and there are no acknowledgement. Therefore, it is the responsibility of the sender to detect the collisions. So how are you going to detect the collision? Using this condition, TT is greater than or equal to 2 into TP. And in order to detect the collision, you should at least have this much amount of data. So this is minimum amount of data, which is equal to 2 into TP into bandwidth. If you don't have this much amount of data, you cannot transmit the packet. Okay, so that is why we go for padding. So padding is used in order to increase the data. Fine. So we shall see what is the efficiency of CSMACD now. Now let's see the efficiency of CSMACD. Sometimes you know it is also called as efficiency of Ethernet. The reason is the CSMACD is used in Ethernet. So in exam, either they ask you about Ethernet or CSMACD. Don't get confused. Both are almost same. And now, let's see what happens in CSMACD. So whenever a station wants to transmit a data, a station tries to transmit a data. At the same time, some other station on the way might transmit the data, and there might be a collision. Therefore, before any successful transmission, there will be a lot of collisions, and after a lot of collisions, there will be a successful transmission and then a propagation, which means, let us say this is the timeline. This is the timeline, and whenever any station tries to transmit the data, there will be collision. So in worst case, if consider this scenario. Say A is here and B is here. If A starts transmitting now, in worst case, after how much time will A find out that its data is lost in collision? In worst case, what happens is its data, A will start transmitting, and after 1 TP, A's data will be at the other side. And now let us say collision has happened here with B, and now the collision signal is coming back. Therefore, in worst case, collision signal will come back after 2 into TP time. Then what will A do? A will stop the communication, which means at least 2 into TP time will be wasted because of a collision. I mean, in worst case. And there will be some more delay too, but then now, to keep this matter simple, for now consider that only 2 into TP time is wasted for every collision. So before starting the transmission, before a packet gets transmitted, there might be a collision. It is not always true that there will be a collision all the time. And what is the time wasted for this collision? So in worst case, time wasted is 2 into TP, isn't it? Let's call this slot as collision slot or contention slot. Okay, so collision slot or contention slot is nothing but the time wasted because of a collision. Now how many such collisions will happen? See this. Now let us assume A has started the transmission and it got involved with collision with B. And again after some time, which is also called as back off time, A will again start transmitting and it might get involved in collision, or B will start transmitting and it might get involved in collision, which means before a successful transmission, there can be many number of collisions and there will be a time waste of 2 into TP for every collision. And how many collisions will take place exactly, that we don't know, that we have to find out, right? And again, this is the contention slot whose time is 2 into TP, right? Before any successful transmission, there will be many contention slots. So after few contention slots, how many we don't know, after few contention slots there will be a successful transmission. Successful transmission means sometime luckily a station will get the chance to transmit the data. Okay, so let us say A got the access over the link, and now A is transmitting the data. How long will A transmit the data? For a time equal to TT. Therefore, A will transmit the data for a time that is equal to TT, transmission delay. And after transmitting the data, A should wait for the last bit transmitted to get out of the link. How much time will it take for the last bit to get out of the link? It is TP. Got it? So for one successful transmission, there will be many collision slots before it. After that, there will be a transmission of the packet, and after that the packet has to propagate. Say this is the timeline growing like this. And what happens after this? Again, some other station will try sending the data, and there will be few contention slots. Right? And after that, how many we don't know. And after that, there will be a transmission delay and there will be a propagation delay, and this will go on, right? So in order to find out the efficiency of any protocol, what is the formula? Useful time upon total time, or cycle time. So in this case, what is the cycle? Cycle is something which repeats over and again, right? So in this case, cycle is this entire part: collisions, transmission, propagation. And cycle is this entire part: collision, transmission, propagation, right? So coming to this question, the efficiency is, in this protocol, the efficiency is eta equal to useful time, let us say cycle time first. Cycle time. What is the total cycle time? There are some collision slots. I don't know how many collisions are there. Let me represent that number with C. So C number of collision slots or contention slots, and each contention slot time is 2 into TP. Yes, C into 2 into TP plus time taken to transmit one packet, which is TT, plus time taken to propagate that packet, which is TP, right? So this is the entire cycle time. So there are some collision slots, and there is a transmission delay, and there is a propagation delay, right? Now this is the entire cycle time, and in this time, what is the useful time? Useful time is nothing but TT, right? So we know all the parameters, what is TT, what is TP, and we know these two, but then we don't know what is the number of collisions, which means how many collisions are, you know, going to be there over a long period of time. So we are going to do some probabilistic analysis here to find out the number of collisions which will happen before the first successful transmission. For that, let's assume that I'll go step by step, try to follow this. So step number one is, let's assume that there are n number of stations, connected to CSMACD. That is the first step. So n number of stations are connected to CSMACD network, and every station wants to send the data with a probability p, small p. There are n stations connected to the CSMACD network, and every station wants to send the data with a probability p, which means there are n stations connected to this. Total number of stations are n hosts, and every station wants to transmit a data with a probability p. Okay, now when will there be a successful transmission? In this case, there will be a successful transmission only when one station transmits the data and all the remaining stations refrain. See, what is unsuccessful transmission here? There will be a collision whenever more than one station transmits the data at the same time. And when will there be no transmission, no collision? When only one station transmits the data and all the other stations, n minus one stations, doesn't transmit the data. Therefore, I'm worried about what is the probability for successful transmission, or what is the probability for success. So probability for success. Probability for success is when only one station, transmits the data. This is the probability for success, right? So we get a success only when one station transmits the data. Then what is the success probability? So success probability is, if there are n stations which are willing to send the data with a probability p, then what is the probability that only one station will transmit is nc1, only one station, one of them has to propagate, which means with probability p, and all the remaining n minus 1 stations should not propagate, which means this one. Okay, so out of n stations, only one station should propagate the data, and the remaining n minus 1 station should not propagate the data. This is the probability for success. Now I want to find out what is the maximum value of this success probability. So how can I find out the maximum value of success probability is, differentiate the probability for success with respect to dp by d small p. With respect to this p, you differentiate it and you equate it to 0, and you have to differentiate it two times and see that the value is less than 0. Then only you can say that the value of p success will be maximum at some value of p. If you do this, then I get that, you please do it, then I get that at a value of p equal to 1 by n, when small p equal to 1 by n, then success probability will be maximum. When p equal to 1 by n, then success probability will be maximum. Okay, then what is this maximum success probability is? Maximum success probability is, you have to substitute p equal to 1 by n there. If I substitute p equal to 1 by n, then 1 minus 1 by n, this one gets cancelled, or if you want to substitute it, I'll substitute it. So that is equal to n into p is 1 by n into p is 1 minus 1 by n to the power n minus 1. So that equal to 1 minus 1 by n to the power n minus 1, which means maximum success is depending on the number of stations. What is n? N is the number of stations connected to the CSCS-MACD network, right? Now if I assume that there are sufficiently large number of stations, which means if I put limit n tends to infinity, if I want to find out what is the p max, and under the limit n tends to infinity, which means if there are sufficiently large number of stations, if you put limit n tends to infinity to this function, you will be getting 1 by e. So this one we shall discuss in limits and continuity. How do you get 1 by e? Using L'Hospital rule we get it. I'll discuss it once we go to limits and continuity. Okay, so now you should understand one thing. Now there are n stations, each station wants to send with a probability of p, transmit with a probability of p, and then the success is there whenever only one station propagates and all the remaining n minus 1 stations doesn't propagate, and that station could be any one of them. So this is also called as binomial distribution. If you remember, it is nothing but tossing n coins, and the probability of a head is p, then what is the probability that we get exactly one head? Nc1 into p into 1 minus 1, 1 minus p power n minus 1, right? So now we got that the maximum probability of success is 1 by e, which means this is the probability with which we might get a success, right? So now the third step is, if this is the probability of success, then how many times should I try before I get the first success? That is, if you remember it is Poisson distribution. If I have a coin with a probability p of getting a head, how many times should I at least toss the coin to get the first head? It is nothing but 1 by p. If you remember that Poisson distribution, it will be easy. So I am just thinking that you know the Poisson distribution. According to Poisson distribution, then number of tries, if this is the probability for maximum success, then how many number of times we should try before getting the first success? Right, so if this is the probability for success, how many number of times should I try before getting the first success is 1 by p. So the value is 1 by p max, right? So what is 1 by p max here? 1 by p max is nothing but 1 by 1 by e, that equal to e, which means you should try at least for e times before you get the first success. How did I get this? By Poisson distribution. How did I get this? By binomial distribution. Therefore, if you have n stations, before any station could successfully transmit a packet, there has to be e number of tries. So what do I mean by e number of tries? All the e tries are unsuccessful. What are unsuccessful tries? Nothing but collisions. Therefore, number of collisions before any successful transmission is roughly going to be e, according to probabilistic analysis. See, this analysis is done over a long period of time, assuming that there are lot of stations and every station is having probability of p. Under those conditions, this is true. So what did we get? The average number of failures before any successful transmission is 1 by e. Therefore, there are e number of collisions before any successful transmission. right? So if number of collisions are E, which means in this formula we are substitute C equal to E, right? So now let's see what is the efficiency. Hoping that you understood everything. If you didn't understand, please rewind the video and again go through it. So I'm going to substitute in place of C, E. So why in place of C I'm putting E? Because number of collisions I found out is equal to E. Then efficiency is equal to TT upon E into 2 into TP plus TT plus TP. So if you substitute the value of E and if you substitute all the other things and if you divide numerator and denominator with the TT, then I get this value to be roughly 1 by 1 plus 6.44A. So this is the value of efficiency. Therefore, efficiency of CSMS CD or Ethernet is 1 by 1 upon 6.44A. So this is the efficiency formula, right? Now let us analyze the efficiency. How does it increase or how does it decrease with various parameters involved? Okay. So you could pause the video and you could write down all these points. I'm going to continue the next step. So I want to analyze what is the efficiency of CSMS CD. So you found out that efficiency of the CSMS CD is 1 upon 1 plus 6.44A, where A is TP upon TT. TP upon TT, right? Now what is TP? That equal to 1 upon 1 plus 6.44 into TP is nothing but D by V, distance by velocity, and TT is nothing but L by B. Therefore, I am going to get B by L since it is in denominator, right? Now just see this. What is the relationship between the efficiency and the distance? As the distance increases, the efficiency decreases. Why? As the distance increases, the denominator part is going to increase and the efficiency is going to decrease. So which means that CSMS CD is not suitable for WANs. It is suitable for small distances, which is nothing but LANs. Therefore, CSMS CD has better utilization in LANs compared to WANs. You can make a note of this point. As the distance increases, efficiency decreases. Therefore, CSMS CD is useful for LANs where the distance is less, and it is not useful for WANs where the distance is more, right? And next thing you should observe is, see, velocity and bandwidth, we don't do anything with them, which means we don't generally increase or decrease the velocity or bandwidth. They are generally fixed in a channel. And coming to the length of the packet or size of the packet, if you observe this L, as the size of the packet increases, if I increase the size of the packet, this entire denominator is going to decrease. If this is going to decrease, efficiency is going to increase. So you should understand that if I send bigger packets, I'll get better efficiency, right? So bigger is better in this case, which means if I send large packets, then I'm going to get good efficiency. Why is this so? Why do you think that if I increase the size of the packet, I get the better efficiency? You could think of it this way. See, now let us say there are various toll gates, and now there are four cars here and one bus here, and this is the toll gate. Now you are driving from here. Where do you want to stand? Do you want to stand behind these four cars, or do you want to stand behind this bus? If this is the toll gate, and you know, if these are the tolls, and if there are four cars, and then this is, and your car is here, where do you want to stand? Behind these four cars or behind this bus? Answer is simple. You would like to go and stand behind this bus. The reason is, this one big bus will just pay the toll price one time and it will not stop. It will continuously go out and it will go out faster, right? Similarly, if I have four small packets and if I have to transmit four small packets one after the other, there will be collisions involved for every packet at the beginning, isn't it? So if you see this, this is the overhead. Come to this point. See, if you are looking at this, this is the overhead. Every packet has to take the overhead and then pass through the network, right? But if you have a bigger packet, once it pays this overhead, then its transmission time can be large, which is useful time, therefore efficiency is more. If I send smaller packets, what happens is every small packet has to pay this overhead, and then transmission delay will be smaller, therefore efficiency is obviously going to fall down. So if you want the better efficiency, since you are already paying fine for every packet, then it is better that you send bigger packets, right? So for bigger packets, efficiency is better, and for LANs, efficiency is better. So CSMS CD, so then my question is this: if for bigger packets efficiency is better, why can't we send packets of very huge sizes? Then also we are going to restrict the packet size. The reason is, if I allow large amounts of data to be sent in just one packet, what happens is a station, if it starts sending the data, it will never stop. It could be the case that it wants to send terabytes of data and it will keep on sending. So once the station's first bit has reached the other end of the network, then no station will be able to send the data, because protocol says that if it is busy, they should stop, which means this kind of scenario will lead to monopolization of a station. That is why, even though bigger packets are going to give us better efficiency, we don't generally go beyond some limitation, which means we generally have a restriction about what is the maximum data that has to be sent. In general, the maximum data here is 1500 bytes in Ethernet. In Ethernet, 1500 bytes is the maximum amount of data that you should send. Even though if you send 1 GB, 2 GB, terabytes of data, the efficiency is large, you are not supposed to send that much data, because it might lead to monopolization, right? So we shall see how to resolve the collisions now.